at this, see? Is that enough for you?
Brought to you in part by St. Croix Rods, best rods on earth. Strike King Lure Company, number one in fishing lures. Ardent, pure performance, all American. This week on Extreme Angler TV.
There we go. It feels good too. Oh, Mr. Smallmouth. Hey, this week on your 2 minute tip, it's fishing those high pressured docks, floating docks.
We'll be right back.
Hey, welcome back to Extreme Angler. This week, as you can tell the way I'm dressed, it's fall. The temperatures drop down, start to bundle up. There are no more shorts and t-shirts for me this time of year, unless I'm down in Tennessee or Alabama. But here in Southern Ontario, when the cold nights come, I get excited. You know why? Crappie, walleye, pike, largemouth, smallmouth, they all go on the feed. Everywhere across the country, US, you name it, anywhere those species live, they're gonna go on the bite. When the nights get cold and the first frosts come. What I'm gonna do is hair jig. Very, very simple. A little lead head with a hook, some bucktail tied on, a little bit of tinsel for some flash. Very simple. 6'6" medium action rod with the Evercast 1000 and 2000, 20 pound braid. Real simple setup. This is gonna be about endurance and stubbornness. Am I talking about the fish? No, me. How many times can I just keep pitching that thing into the weeds and ripping it? I'm looking for a reaction strike. I'm talking about getting right down where they live, in where they're chasing perch, emeralds, whatever they're eating. I want this bait to be in that same area and get a reaction strike. When it's coming through that weed, they're just their natural reaction is to see what it is to try to eat it. You know, it's a little bit cloudy, but what I'm looking for is the sun to come a little higher and those fish tuck in tighter. Because when they tuck in tighter, this presentation of ripping or jerking that little hair jig in the weeds gets a reaction strike. And that hook protruding, just like a flipping jig on largemouth, when you lift up and it's there, 9 times out of 10, or 99.9% of the time, those fish are hooked, they stay hooked, they get in the boat. Let's go have some fun. The biggest thing with this technique and presentation is not making long bomb casts. You hear me say that all the time. When I'm throwing topwaters, that's one thing. But when I'm working vertical stuff, this is vertical, but I'm covering water. I'm ripping it about 30 feet ahead of the boat, and I'm watching that line. I don't take my eyes off it, just beaded right on it, because sometimes when it falls, even with the really good, you know, Legend Extremes and the braid, they take it in so soft. I guess they look at it like it's so real. They just pull it in, you lift, and there's a fish there.
Yeah.
So watching it fall, then it go down. When I figure it's in the bottom, I pick up a bit of slack, whack, and I rip it up. That little reaction of it going through the weed and ripping, going back down again, I'm staying in that strike zone. It's close to their face. They see it. But the biggest thing with this presentation out here like this, this weed, it's persistence. And it's just like flipping docks, fishing pads, topwater, whatever. You got to put in your time. No spot, you know, unless you're on a magic hole where you cast, fish. This is about working the weed beds, working the edges, find them. Sun's coming out, sun goes away. They move around. They're just chasing the bait this time of year. You see how big their bellies are. So it's a matter of just being persistent, putting the bait out close to you, and dissect that water in front of you, and then keep on the trolling motor, left, right, zigzag. Watch your waypoints, dissect the weeds, And you're gonna catch those fish with the bucktail. There we go. It feels good too. Oh, Mr. Smallmouth. Look what we found. Yeah, Mr. Smallmouth. He's not a real big example of what we're looking for. But anytime I can cover water when it starts getting cold, and I can throw a hair jig, and I can catch all kinds of species, from walleye, largemouth, pike, crappie, and smallmouth. Look who's got that, eh? Something about that. When you just can just set with the braid, and it pulls back. Hopefully he's one of the smaller ones that we're gonna catch today, but he's ice cold, the water's cold, and we're hoping the fishing is gonna get hot. Like I said when I started out, all I'm gonna do, you've seen it before, an extreme angler, is go around, bundle up, find a presentation that I could throw, and just debunk all the wives' tales about slowing down in the fall, etc. Tell you, fish are on the feed bag. You put the right bait in the right spots, and sometimes use a bait for looking for a reaction strike. And that's what I'm doing today with the hair jig, throwing it, ripping it. So I see it going through the weeds. Looks like minnow's taking off. As it's falling, boom, they usually hit it. Sometimes, like on that first fish, lift up and he's ready there. It's incredible how they can just suck it in without you feeling it with a braid and a great rod. A little bit of cloud cover this morning, so I think there'll be a little bit more on the outside edges of the weeds. But I'm gonna move around. That fish showed me already that they're willing to eat it, so I'll keep throwing it and hopefully keep catching. Boy, it's just a matter of putting in the time, eh? It's like pitching 1,000 docks and all of a sudden, tick. Ripping the, ripping. Repetition, going along. Short pitches ahead of the boat. Dissect the weed bed. Find the ones that want to eat. Provoke them. Yeah. Oh, big one too. That one hit right away. Look how fat that guy is. Oh boy. Look how fat he is. He banged it right in the top of the weeds. Oh yeah. That's what I'm looking for right here. Like a football. Look at him. Hey, you talk about a football. You know, you talk about smallmouth bass being shaped like footballs. I don't know if you can get any closer than that right there. Look at that thing. Hey, look at that thing right there. You're a pretty little fish. Look where you got that. There's no missing that bite when they eat it like that. Look at him. He's got some girth on him. Look at his back. Big belly. Look at that. You think they're eating? Look at that. Gonna put him in there for some pictures. But look at just a beautiful northern smallmouth bass. Ripping on the hair. Oh, gotta love it, man. When you feel those bigger fish. Look at that. Just a gorgeous fish. That's what I wanted to catch. That's what I came for. And that's why I bundle up, pick up the hair jig. You know, those spinning rods have been sitting all summer with fluorocarbon, monofilament, and different things, fishing docks and grubs and tube jigs and zeros and all that kind of stuff. But once October comes and those temperatures go down, the water temperature's in the high 40s, low 50s, put on the braid, put on the hair jig, the menace jig, different small little football jigs, and get into those weeds, find those little offshore humps away from the shore where the bait is, where the loons are feeding. Those are eating. Warm up fast when that happens. Let's get back at it, catch some more. People say, oh man, the sun, I love the sun, even in the fall. You know what? It pushes those fish where I want them to be, in the clumps. I want the little hair jig to be ripping through that heavier cover, something they can relate to. The bait fish is in there, they're in there roaming around. If it's really cloudy, you know, or a lot of chopping water, they could wander anywhere. The flatter it is, the sunnier it is, especially this time of year, boom, they go in the stuff that I want them to go in, where this hair jig's gonna go in, that weed. Here, fishy, fishy, fishy. Where are you? So cool, you know, because you think fish sometimes it's all that natural stuff. It's got to look perfect and stuff. Yeah, okay, you're dragging tubes and throwing baits on their nose and stuff. But when you're going after a reaction strike, like burning a spinner bait, throwing a jerk bait, or ripping a hair jig, it's more about getting that bait close to the fish and provoking the strike then waiting them to look at it and look, does it look like a crayfish? Does it look like a perch or a smelt? Doesn't matter. This is all about a little bit of flash, getting the right bait in the right spot, provoking the strikes. It's totally different than playing around with lots of different colors. This color gives me confidence. That's why I'm throwing it. Yeah. Look at this one. Look, I'm on top of the weed. Whoa. Hey. Gotta love that, man. Gotta love it. When you just feel that sensation of the weight, man, it is, I tell you, it's phenomenal. And he ran along the surface. Look at him fight still. He's got some spunk. They can't go too crazy. Got the media action rod. Oh, and once they're in that lucky strike, guess what? They end up in the boat. Oh, you're almost a twin of the other one. You're not as big as the other one, but you are a twin. Look where he's got it to, son of a gun, eh? Right through the yap. Look at that. That's where he's sitting, that junky looking weed. And that's what they look like right there. Wanna join your friend? You got the same belly as your friend. Boy, all over the Great Lakes and St. Clair, Erie, Simcoe, you name it, they're all doing the same thing. Except here, they're in the thick weed and I can just power fish him with that bucktail. It's a lot of fun. Let's put him in there, he fought nice. We'll let him go. And the beauty of this is, it's not real deep water, so I can put them in the live well. And don't have to worry about fizzing them. You know, their bladder gets all messed up when you catch them in deep water. The beauty is, in the shallower stuff, it's not like that. They live in this stuff. It's only 7-8 feet of water they're sitting on here, and it's not a real deep cottage lake. So they come up here to feed. You can put them in there, take some pictures of them, let them go, and they're healthy. They don't come to the surface. Their bladders don't get messed up. But it's the way I'm fishing, throwing that out. Woof, woof. Watch my line on the way down. The odd time, you just lift up and he's there. And sometimes when they're cruising maybe higher in the weed, as the jig's going down, just a real light little thunk, you feel it, and you gotta pull them through that weed, hence the braid. Don't worry about them seeing it. All they're looking at is seeing that hair jig go choo, choo. When they see that go up and down like that, the reaction, woof, what was it? Doom, whack. Regroup, let's catch one more. A deep edge right here, 10 feet. There's gotta be a critter around here. Right in there, big hole. I told ya, he's big too. Oh, he's not big, but he's nice. I just saw a little hole in the weeds. Look at that, let's look at him go, eh? Gorgeous, gorgeous smallmouth. And I think he's got it where the other one's got it. Yeah, look at that. Unbelievable, eh? You talk about high hooking percentage, man. Look at that. Sharp hooks. He not big enough to put in the live well. But I'm telling you, killer technique in the fall, catching smallmouth bass on a reaction strike. Putting it in, ripping it. Get myself warm. Speaking of, the sun comes out, I'm getting warm. I gotta get this off. Listen, stick around. We'll be right back after commercial break. My very fine sponsors on Extreme Angler, ripping up some more fall smallmouth with the hair jig on a beautiful October day. Stick around. And now it's time for the Cottage Angler, presented by St. Croix Rods, best rods on earth. Hey, this week on our 2-minute tip, it's fishing those high pressured docks, floating docks in marinas, on docks, on public lakes, where you have to stay back, clear water. There's nothing harder to catch than spooked bass, trust me. But why let them know that you're there? What I like to try is a technique that guys have been using for years, and it's called skipping. Okay, you stay back, and you just pitch the bait. Just pitch it, let it skip. It almost looks like shad or something on the surface, injured bait fish being chased and things like that. And if a fish is looking at that, and just seeing the little splashing, And if you've got either a little zero or a little finesse worm, something of a small profile that will, after you cast it, and just skims along the surface and slowly sinks, what you're doing is creating that interest from the fish. They see the splash, splash, splash. All of a sudden, a slow bait going down. You're staying in the strike zone a long time. That's what you want. Create interest, stay in the strike zone. They're gonna bite it, they're gonna eat it. And you see what I'm doing is, I'm staying back. I'm looking for shadowed areas, anywhere where a fish could sit and suspend. Now, I don't do this a lot on real murky and dirty waters. It does work, but I like doing it on clear water with some depth in the shade where the fish have to sit up or suspend under those shaded areas. They have limited areas to go to in that clear water, especially if they hang around marinas and stuff like this. So it's either gonna be boats, pontoon boats, or things on the surface that they can sit right against it. So you have to stay back, skip your bait, create the interest, and let it stay in that strike zone, and you know they're gonna try to eat it. I'll just work my way up along the dock section, skip it all the way up inside, and watch it. A few twitches. If it's a fish there, he's gonna take at least one shot at it. If he does, he's mine. Love that weed, man. Close to those weeds, in the thick stuff, on the edges. Seems, man, when those cloud covers up that sun, they just almost pull like to the edges, the holes. You gotta be willing to adapt to that. Don't stay right in the real thick stuff if you're not getting bit. The sun comes out, seems like boom, go out again in the thick. They're moving around, chasing whatever it is they're eating in here. Perch, shiners, chub. And I'm sure they're sleeping some crayfish by looking at all the gravel and stuff on the bottom. Yeah. Now I'm pulling this thing through here. What are you, walleye? Oh no, did he ever nail that? This is where I definitely have to have some drag system on here. Look at him go. I'm gonna bury the rod. That line doesn't get caught under the boat. Here, what I've been coming after here. This is what makes me come out in the fall, right here. Look at how tough they are. Look at the weed. Look where she wants to go. Swam right into the net. Look where it got it. She's a beautiful long fish. Look at that, eh? Look where that hook is right there. Whoa. It's tension on. Nice long one. They look so creepy in the water when they're so long like that. It's got a belly. Join a couple of your friends. I'm telling you, it's phenomenal. When you can come out and catch them with power techniques like this in the fall and get beautiful bass like that. And the beauty is, this cold water, it's like 50 degrees, it's great. And they're shallow, you don't worry about fizzing them, do anything. Just catch them, take some pictures, let them go, and have it in your memory bank of how much fun it is to get out when there's no one else around, just you and the bass. You know, you say to yourself, okay, how far do you let the bait go down and stuff like that? You let the fish tell you, but what I do is I pitch out and I watch the line go down, seeing the bow in the line. When it's on the bottom, you get slack, rip up. Sometimes those walleye and smallmouth, even the largemouth, pick it up off the bottom like this, like when you get the little bit of slack in the line. That's the times when you probably don't feel those little bites. You lift up and he's already there. That's why you gotta pay attention. But most times, you pitch out like that, let it go down, rip. Let it go down, rip. So I'm getting, you know, those bigger fish not feeling the bite. So that tells me they're closer to the bottom. I got one decent one on top, maybe swimming through the weeds and stuff where I felt a specific tick. But a lot of times, when you throw it like that, you don't feel anything. You just watch, goes to the bottom, lift up, the fish is there. If you're feeling the ticks, you know they're higher in the water column. So if you're in 10 feet of water, just get a gauge of how deep you think those fish are. But over here, overall, I've been fishing at 8-9 foot. We're gonna get some of those bigger fish, and I'm getting them on the lift, off the bottom. So you know what? It just tells me they're close to the bottom. You want that jig close to the bottom, and then rip up, pay attention, and you're gonna get them. Oh, I missed them. Wow. How do you miss those? You can't miss those. Come on, boy. Come on, man. Just finished saying two weight.
Right there, right there.
Look at that guy. Oh. That's a nice fish, eh? Just missed one too. Just missed one. He came back. I don't know if it's the same fish or a cousin of his. Oh, got me with the glass. He splashed me right in the face. And just bend it like that so it pops out. I gotta put him in there because I just do not want to spook these fish in this weed bed. We're gonna let them all go. But just missed one. Stayed in the same area, 12 feet. This clumpy stuff going into the main stuff that's over there. Missed one. Got one like that. I'll put him in there. We'll call him out soon. I tell ya, he got me good. He splashed me good. But I cannot stand losing fish. I know I felt that real distinct tink. Oh, I missed it right back in the exact same spot. Clumps, clumps, hole going out, dropping off to 12 feet. Open, sporadic, sandy, going out to the main lake there. Next pitch, going down. One or two rips. Very distinct. Tells me there might be more fish there because he wanted to eat before somebody else grabbed them. So I'm almost done for the morning. Having a fantastic time. It's not that cold. This morning is a little chilly, but I tell you, when the first frost comes, that switch turns on for those smallmouth to eat. You got to get out there and catch them because it is a blast. Let's keep going. My drag is fairly tight. Look at that. It takes a lot of effort to pull that out because I want, when I lift, when I don't feel the bites, that's the thing. When I feel the bites, I can reel down any slack, give it to them. So there's virtually no stretch at all in the braid, but I want to make sure that that hook penetration goes right in right away. So it's really tight. The fish has some size, I'll back off. He can pull by the boat a bit, wear him out a little bit, so that hook doesn't pull out of that skin. You land the fish. Oh, there you go. I've had a fantastic morning catching these fish. I tell you, I fish all summer long, all spring in the States, winter, you name it, all kinds of stuff. But something magical about the fall, getting out, my favorite sticks, chasing largemouth, smallmouth, walleye, big crappie. But those smallmouth, with the power techniques like the football jig and the hair jig in shoals, rocks, and weeds, it's very dear to me, boy, because it is just fun going out and being more persistent and more stubborn than them. Just keep ripping, ripping. Put in your dues and you're gonna catch them. If you haven't done this kind of technique yet, or smallmouth, walleye, etc., I strongly suggest you give it a try. Go find some bucktails, good St. Croix rod, 20 pound braid, good Evercast reels. You're gonna catch them just like you saw I did this morning. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time on Extreme Angler TV. And if you want more Extreme Angler, go to our website, extremeanglertv.com, and I'm sure you'll find us on all your popular social networks, YouTube, Twitter, and Facebook, because I know you're gonna like us.